still saying it's another 5 months. It seems 6 years to make a decision, isn't it?
The only thing I'd say, it's a 10-year straight study programme with all the things proprietary to come along, which, you know, building headquarters, it will take a lot of our time to do that, and probably that's the priority. A lot of things have to drop down the line and get pushed back.
There's an issue raised in the report, for example, about the forensic science unit and whether or not it's based in the new forces quarters on that issue. One of the other issues that isn't specifically referred to in the report, but clearly as part of the estate strategy, is in relation to Allerton and the location of the police commissioner. So in both of those, where are we at and what is the intended or likely solutions that are being pursued?
So Allerton police station has literally gone on sale, I think, yesterday. And it's put out jointly with the fire station next door as well. So that is literally the force just put on out up to the market in the minute, and then we'll be relocating to wherever they find space for us, I think. And then what was the other one, sorry?
Well, as I say, the proposal in terms of the new force headquarters, the report is basically saying that we're now in a position where the forensic science is not likely to be part of that development, and therefore if it isn't, some alternative needs to be sought. In the same way we're looking at the higher range being relocated elsewhere, because it would seem not to be make sense. So what are the options that are being explored in terms of alternatives for, say, the forensic science? And indeed the long-term question, the long-term location of the police commissioner. Because again, that was considered to be within the police headquarters. Is that still being considered?
I think longer term, when the new HQ is built, there is a proposal that the commissioner's office will move there. But obviously that's going to be a few years down the line. I think when the operational command centre is open, there'll be lots of staff shifting around, and so lots of people who, for example, are in Mather Avenue now will be potentially moving over to the new command centre, so that frees up space for us to move out, for example. So that's not been confirmed, but that's what will happen when the shift happens. And then in terms of the forensic science unit, we think it's still going to be an issue.
Yeah, in that quarter. So a separate block and on the same patch of land. So.
On the same patch?
Yeah.
So are the panel happy to endorse the adopted approach?
Yeah.
Deputy Commissioner, can I ask as well that further update is provided in the state strategy for 2018 and 19?
Yeah. Yeah,
right, if we move on to item 8.
Okay, so this is, we've talked about this a few times over the last few months at the panel meeting, and this is the update on the provision of the appropriate adults service for vulnerable adults who are in police custody. There's a requirement that an appropriate adult is available when juveniles or vulnerable adults are interviewed. Local authorities have a statutory duty to provide it for juveniles but not for vulnerable adults. So until recently there has been a gap that was plugged by local authorities, but since the budget cuts have come in, only Liverpool has retained that capacity, so there was no other support available for appropriate adult provision. So as some of you will remember, that in March 2016, the PCC agreed to fund a short-term solution to the problem and funded the service. It was then extended from April to run until April 2018. However, we're rapidly approaching April 2018 and the funding is just not going to be there following this. The PCC was asked to put a paper together to be submitted to the Merseyside Criminal Justice Board. That is going to, no, I'm lying, not the Criminal Board, the Liverpool City Region Strategic Leadership Board. I don't like to have one name for this board, don't I? So there's a report going to that group, which is the Directors of Adult Services for all the local authorities. So that report is going in November to look at what the implications are. And broadly, there are three options. Option one is to remain as it is, which, as I've just said, the PCC doesn't have the funding to keep doing that. So that isn't really available for next year. Option two is to commission the Merseyside Y service by tender. And then option three is to commission the Merseyside Y service on a spot purchase basis. And there's various protocols that come with that. So the paper just outlines those options. Any questions?
Option two, where does funding come from?
That's a good question. I think the conversations are ongoing with the local authorities to see whether they would be willing to contribute and to try and pull funding, and then hopefully make some savings by doing it Merseyside wide and looking at negotiating the cost of each attendance, for example. But as I say, conversations are ongoing, so whether that will happen or not.
I mean, I'm worried that this is an essential service, and we're in the lap of the drops as to who can afford it. We were with the commissioner, obviously, and we've looked at that issue. We now with local authorities, who, as we know, are as strapped for cash, if not more so, than the police. But we have an essential service here, which is at risk of going under because of lack of resources to meet. I think we still need to be making, I'm sure the Commissioner is, the highest recommendations to the government in terms of continuing this essential service.
Just on that point, the person has read to the police and the fire officer to apply. What we're doing on Merseyside, the challenges we face, the usefulness of a change in legislation, to make it the responsibility of local authority, similar to young people, to appropriate adult provision, who will be able to pay about 400 have to be put. And so that letter has gone to effect.
And I believe he has sent a letter replying that it states that it should be the responsibility of local authorities. Obviously, it's not statutory, but he has clearly identified that it should be local authorities that fund this.
Chair, can I? Sorry. I mean, you've had discussions. 2016, 2017, with the health agencies, the local authorities, and no one's giving money. And like I said, it's quite, I don't think it's likely that local authorities are going to be able to say, you know, so I think there must be a big concern, really, that nothing is going, you know, left in the situation. So, and it is only central government, isn't it, at the end of the day, who've been decided. I don't think that, imagine the officers have done a fantastic job trying to bring all the partners together, but it's just not working.
Thanks, Tony.
Chair, I've been part of the discussions on this item with another hat on. I think the logic that's been adopted is, if you look at the burden on local authorities for young people, they are broadly picked up by the youth offender service during the daytime and emergency duty teams during the night time. And it's quite a significant burden. That's obviously funded through those two routes. I think the conversation, the papers that I've seen that have looked at this, is to say, well, if we did this together rather than individually, could that release capacity and funding from those other two things that will potentially enable us to pick up the adults as well as the children? That I think is the logic. So as well as the conversation with adults, directors of adult services, there was also a conversation with directors of children's services who actually formed that stuff across the local authorities at the moment. And I think that was the broad model that's being proposed to try and see if anything can be released to pick up this gap. And we'll see how that conversation goes.
However, it is the case that all youth offending services throughout Merseyside have been affected by the funding pressures on the local authorities. And staff reductions and restructuring over the past 2 years in order to meet those obligations. So I don't see much future in that, as the colleague said, in being achieved.
Right. Are there any other queries or questions we have? So we're satisfied with the approach adopted by the Commission and does the panel want to request a further update on the provision of the appropriate adult service at the December panel meeting or informally between meetings following the decision made on the future service at the PCT region strategic leadership?
think it needs to be kept informed, Chair, because in my view, the authorities, obviously, colleagues from local authorities have literally said it, in my view, local authorities are under such pressure that it's not really practical to just say, leave it with them. We need to be aware of decisions and be able to reinforce where we can what the Commissioner is doing to achieve the proper results.
We
do bring up the fact that
we need to follow that.
If we now move on to item 9, about community engagement.
So this is just an update on the work of the community engagement of the Commissioner's office. It highlights the number of meetings that the Commissioner and I and others have attended. So this is from the 6th of January. There's been 191 engagement events, 39 of which have been attended by the PCC. And overall, there's been, when the report was written, it was 4,030 people, but actually, because of all the work that's been going on with the victims and needs analysis, that's actually gone up by 2,000, so we're actually closer to 6,000 now of people, individual people who have been engaged with. So the report has outlined some of the different ways that the staff engage with the communities, different events and meetings that they attend, and the community engagement team will feedback anything they attend to myself or the Commissioner and have any issues that need to be picked up as well.
Chair, does the Commissioner team actually organise any events themselves rather than piggybacking on to other community events? Do you have a calendar of events that your engagement team have put together?
No, so the decision was taken that it was preferable to, as you say, piggyback onto the events that the community do, partly because I think you get a more honest view of the community and you're kind of taking part in something they've done rather than trying to force it to become something that you are organising. I think the Commissioner's felt that that gets a better response and she's able to more understand and get a feel for the community and go into their events rather than putting on our own necessarily.
I just wanted to make a comment because one of these came up first time I've seen it was the healthiest thoughts of the community.
Yes.
This was more than 2,000 pounds. Prior to them, this started a few weeks ago. Prior to that we'd had 4 months of anti social behaviour in the area, which was up 4 months for the residents. And just by chance I was there the day after this started, and one of the residents actually said to me, for some reason it was quiet, wasn't it? And since this has started, antisocial behaviour dramatically, but it's fantastic to watch. So I just want to say, great response and thank you.
I think I'm going to come and visit it as well.
That's the one I wanted to come and see.
Yeah.
Maybe because when I first asked the injury, so much antisocial behaviour.
Yeah.
But even so, it'd be nice to see it.
Yeah, I know.
So just how effective this one is.
That's all
we
have to do. Are there any other questions from the panel? Right, are we satisfied with the approach adopted in this community engagement team? Yeah. Okay, great. We'll move on to agenda item 10.
So yeah, this is the usual agenda item of things that we've asked for previously. I think they're all up to date, but I'm not to do that anymore.
Have all of the responses provided. Okay. Are there any other items that I think that brings the meeting to a close? Thank you very much for your attendance.